Hi, this is Dr. Vallesh. Welcome to Pharmacology Simplified. Today I am going to speak about different types of mydriasis. This topic is important for your practical exam, your viva and entrance tests. It's unlikely that this topic will be asked in your theory exam. Mydriasis is widening of pupil and meiosis is narrowing of pupil. With mydriasis, more light enters your eyes. And with meiosis, less eyes enters your eyes. Mydriasis is seen with sympathetic system activation and meiosis is seen with parasympathetic system activation. How to remember this? Remember that sympathetic system prepares your body for a fight or flight type of response. So whenever there is a fight or flight type of situation, sympathetic system activates. There is mydriasis, more light enters your body, more light enters your eyes. So now you are in a position to see very clearly whom you are fighting or where you are running. On the other hand, during a rest or digest type of response, parasympathetic system gets activated, there is meiosis, less light is entering your eyes, so you can switch off the lights and sleep peacefully. So with sympathetic system activation, there is mydriasis, and parasympathetic system activation, there is meiosis. Now, how do these two systems produce this effect? How do these two systems produce mydriasis and meiosis? Both of these systems act in the eye, act in the iris of the eye. There are two groups of muscle here. One is the sphincter pupillae, the other is the dilator pupillae. Both of these group of neurotransmitters act on these two muscles. There is a sphincter pupillae on which there is M3 receptors. So whenever there is parasympathetic activation, acetylcholine sits on the M3 receptors here and there is contraction of sphincter pupillae leading to meiosis. Whenever there is sympathetic system activation, noradrenaline gets released and it sits on the alpha 1 receptors which are located on the dilator pupillae. There is contraction of dilator pupillae muscle leading to mydriasis. So this is physiology. With sympathetic system activation, alpha 1 receptor gets activated, dilator pupillae contracts, there is mydriasis. With parasympathetic activation, M3 receptors gets activated, there is contraction of sphincter pupillae, there is meiosis. Now, if you want to produce mydriasis using a drug, how would you do that? It's pretty simple, right? You will have the drug act on the alpha 1 receptors located on the dilator pupillae here, leading to contraction of the dilator muscles, leading to mydriasis. Correct? Now, there is another way in which you can accomplish the same contraction of the dilator pupillae, and that is by inhibiting the sphincter pupillae here. You block the M3 receptors, what is going to happen? There is relaxation of the sphincter muscle and all muscles in the body, including smooth muscles of the dilator pupillae, will have their own inherent tone. So if the opposite group of muscle has undergone relaxation, this muscle will undergo contraction and there is mydriasis. Observe that the second type of mydriasis is indirect. You are not actually activating this group of muscle, but you are inhibiting this muscle. As a result, there is indirect mydriasis. So both of these are two ways in which you can produce mydriasis, and these are the two exact names for two types of mydriasis, active mydriasis and passive mydriasis. The active mydriasis you get by activating the alpha 1 receptors here, and passive mydriasis you get by inhibiting or relaxing these muscles here. Okay, that's it. That is the basic difference between active mydriasis and passive mydriasis. You want mydriasis so that you can examine the eye in a better way. So whether it is active mydriasis or passive mydriasis is mydriasis, right? You will have the pupils undergo dilatation. How is it going to make a difference whether it is active mydriasis or passive mydriasis? The answer for this important question lies in the M3 receptors. M3 receptors are not only present in the sphincter pupillae, they are also present on the ciliary muscles here. So if you are using a drug to inhibit the M3 receptors here, the same drug also inhibits the M3 receptors here. So while there is relaxation of the sphincter pupillae here, there is also relaxation of the ciliary muscle. Relaxation of ciliary muscle will lead to a condition called as cycloplegia. So remember, whenever there is passive mydriasis, there is always associated cycloplegia. Same associated condition is not seen with active mydriasis. Okay. Now, mydriasis, the patients the manifestation of mydriasis in a patient will be photophobia because more light is entering the eyes. The manifestation of cycloplegia, you see that this ciliary muscle is connected to the lens Whenever there is cycloplegia, there is loss of accommodation, the patients will complain of blurred vision. Okay, so mydriasis, patients will complain of photophobia. Cycloplegia, patients will complain of blurred vision. I hope this point is clear to you now. So let us see which drugs produce mydriasis. Active mydriasis, passive mydriasis. Now that it should be very clear to you, active mydriasis is produced by which group of drugs? It is by sympathomimetics. Passive mydriasis is produced by which group of drugs? It is anticholinergics. Specifically speaking, which sympathomimetic drugs produce active mydriasis? These drugs should be activating the which receptor? Alpha 1 receptor. So alpha 1 agonist. And here anticholinergics, it should be M3 blockers. So which are all the alpha 1 agonists which produce active mydriasis? There are many drugs, there are quite a few drugs which produce which are alpha 1 agonists. But out of these, we are using only phenylephrine for producing mydriasis. Methoxamine, xylometazoline are also alpha 1 agonists, but we use these two drugs for some other condition. Here, there are a lot of M3 blockers, including atropine, homatropine, cyclopentolate, and tropicamide. But we are using only tropicamide for producing passive mydriasis. We are not using atropine, homatropine, cyclopentolate. The reason for that is the duration of action. When we are using tropicamide, there is both mydriasis and cycloplegia. So patient will have both photophobia and blurring of vision. With atropine, homatropine and cyclopentolate, the duration of action is quite long. With atropine, homatropine, it goes on for many days. For tropicamide, it is just 3 to 4 hours maximum. Okay? So often, we combine phenylephrine and tropicamide to produce better mydriasis. Okay? Remember that both of these drugs are acting by two entirely different mechanisms. So combining these two will lead to better mydriasis. Okay, so let us compare these two side by side, active mydriasis and passive mydriasis. Which muscle and which action is responsible for active mydriasis? Yes, it is dilator pupillae and contraction of dilator pupillae. Passive mydriasis, it is sphincter pupillae and relaxation. What receptor and what action is involved for active mydriasis? It is alpha 1 receptor, agonistic. For passive mydriasis, it is M3 muscarinic inhibition. Are there any associated conditions for active mydriasis? No. But for passive mydriasis, yes, there is always associated with cycloplegia, and that is because of M3 inhibition in ciliary muscles. Drugs causing active mydriasis, phenylephrine. Drugs causing passive mydriasis, tropicamide and other few drugs, homatropine, cyclopentolate, atropine. So are there any contraindications for active mydriasis? No. But for passive mydriasis, there is one specific contraindication. You should avoid passive mydriasis in patients who are at risk of developing glaucoma. Reason for that is, you use M3 blockers. M3 blockers also inhibit ciliary muscles. With that, the outflow of aqueous humor is blocked. And with that, there is increase in intraocular pressure. So active mydriatics are useful for refraction testing and fundoscopy in almost all patients, especially in patients who are at risk of developing glaucoma. Whereas we prefer passive mydriasis, that is mydriasis with cycloplegia. It is called as cycloplegic refraction. We generally use this in children, refraction testing in children. So I hope I have been able to clear this topic for you. Namaste. Have a nice day.